and ensure they attend court. Under the peculiar circumstances of this case, senior counsel argued that charges only demonstrates the transfer, only demonstrated the transfer of funds, and that no criminal offense is disclosed, that no money was demonstrated or lost, stolen, or misused, as was in the cases cited, that there was no allegation that the government participated in such laws, and there is no criminal provision that criminalizes leadership. If I argue that it's not the mandate of this court to give effect to Chapter 6 of the Constitution, nor that of the DPP, and that the DPP's mandate was only to charge, that offences against accused one have no basis in law. Mr. Nyamuki associated himself with the senior counsel's submissions and added that the court should consider and find that there was no benefit bestowed either on accused themselves or other accused beneficiaries. The above are the arguments concerning the various positions taken by the parties. At Court 3 of the Constitution, on the defense of the Constitution, bestows upon every person an obligation to respect and uphold and defend the Constitution. This court is hence clothed with the necessary powers, just like any other person, to uphold and defend the Constitution. Hence, among the duties of this court is to put into effect the Constitution. The only duty this court does not have is to interpret the Constitution. Parliament was to enact legislation to give subordinate courts the powers to interpret the Constitution. It has not done so. In order to arrive at the various decisions on the issue of bail, I have considered the facts in the charges, namely, they deal with transfer of monies within Garissa government, Garissa County government, and mismanagement of the same. Whether this happened is a matter of evidence that can only wait for the trial. I also considered that there was no loss of money, personal gain or benefit, either to accused or to their beneficiaries. I've also considered the roles played by each accused in the alleged mismanagement of funds and the positions held by the accused in the Garissa County. I've also considered the authorities placed before me, and in particular paragraph 8 of the case of FLW Babayao, that is Fana and Bingwaititu Babayao, First Republic 1919 EKNR, where the judge held that, quote, it was not far-fetched for the prosecution to contend that the appellant would most likely interfere with their witnesses or conduct himself in a manner likely to compromise their case if he was not barred from accessing his office during the pendency of the case. There are documented instances of loss and or disappearance of vital documents from certain offices where public or state officers charged with corruption or economic crimes related to their work have been allowed unrestricted access to the offices during the pendency of their cases. Having said as above, it's apparent that I will admit all accused persons to reasonable bail terms in the spirit of the Constitution, and also on the presumption of innocence, also in the spirit of the Constitution, in order to allow the accused to continue with their normal lives, but ensure that they attend trial. I found that accused one faces only 2 counts, accused 2, 6 counts, accused 3, 2 counts, accused 4, 6 counts, accused 5, 6 counts. I also considered the nature of the offences and the sentences to be meted out. In any case, there is a conviction, and I have decided as follows. Accused one to a cash bail of Kenya shillings 3,250,000 or a bond of Kenya shillings 5 million, one trying to have similar amount. Accused 2, 3, 4, 5, 506 to a cash bet of 1,200,000 or a bond of Kenya shillings 3 million with one jointy of similar amount. All accused are hereby barred from the offices, only allowed to visit while accompanied by an officer from the ESCC. They should not make any attempt to approach or interfere with any witness in whatever form. This will lead to automatic cancellation of both terms. All accused to report their passports in court and only to leave the jurisdiction of the court with the court's permission. The parties are to open a common email and the DPP to disclose within 14 days. Counsels are given another 14 days to take instructions. There will be a virtual mention for further directions on 23rd October 2020 at 10 a.m. So that the order.
So most of the breakdown.